In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen.
Amen.
O Lord,
you are the light who shine upon those
who are in darkness,
and they were illumined upon the blind, and they recovered their sight. Let your face now shine upon us, and we shall be illumined by you. Walk in the way of the gospel teachings, and glorify the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen.
Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Hail Mary,
full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for our sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Saint Mary,
pray for us.
In the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
All right, back to our introduction. All right, so the next section on this letter, we're on page 11. At the very top, in the italics, you have the name of a papal encyclical called Orientale Lumen, Eastern Light in Latin. Orientale Lumen. It's from May 2nd, 1995. So, of course, you belong in a very unique period of church history, because we all know the 19th century, all of the Italians and all the Irish Catholics come to America, all right. And they bring their own observances and things. And so if you're near Irish parishes, or excuse me, near Italian parishes, you'll do a St. Joseph's table around St. Joseph's feast day. Because it's a Sicilian custom where everyone would bake and they would donate food in honor of St. Joseph. And then you'd have a big luncheon and all that, and you'd feed the poor in the neighborhood, and you'd give away food. And so when I was in Kansas City, we had a St. Joseph's table. So it existed before I was there. And then when I went to Idaho, I took the Sicilian table with me of St. Joseph and did the devotion, because it's very beautiful. And so you make a whole altar in the parish hall, and you fill it with flowers and breads and pastas, and then you put on a big pasta meal, which of course is Lent. So even if in Sicily and Italy it's a holy day of obligation, it was still going to be vegetarian. So it was pasta and tomato sauce, and they would add, I used to call it sawdust. It was ground up croutons in that, so it was breadcrumbs. Put it to give it some kind of consistency instead of just tomato sauce and pasta. And then what we did is all the food that had been donated, we had a big auction. And so the money that came in was then used for charity and became part of your fund. So it was one of those things, it's a custom. But of course in the 20th century, you begin to have the migration of people who aren't just simply other Latins, Italians, Irish. The Irish don't really bring any customs with them because they've been beaten down for so many centuries by the English. When they come, they don't really have anything. And even corned beef and cabbage is not an Irish custom, it's an American Irish custom. Because when you were in Ireland, you could never afford corned beef. So it became the thing to buy once you were in Boston and in New York. So the only thing the Irish bring is the characteristic of American Catholics with the inability to sing at Mass. That's the Irish influence. Because during all the penal centuries, you were just lucky you could even have Mass. So processions, outdoor things, forget it. So American Catholics who hate processions and tend not to want any kind of overt, that's the Irish influence. Because the German Catholics, if you were in Wisconsin, Minnesota, they had huge processions of Corpus Christi. And you have the Umba bands, and you have processional banners, and you have huge things, because the Germans, they had big processions, like the Italians did. When the Irish came, let's see, the Irish had the biggest influence because they already spoke English. And the Germans, of course, when they came, they had money in their suitcases, so they never stayed in Boston and in New York. They had money because they were going to buy farms in the Midwest, just like home. But what they had created then was the ability to go out and create a new Germany. So you have places in Minnesota called like New Munich, and they just simply set up shop. Sermons were in German, schools were in German, everything was in German, and they formed a parallel, including German newspapers. They formed an entire parallel universe, and all of that richness of their Catholic Germanic culture never had an influence upon the American church, sadly. And by the time they started not using German, it was 1950, and well, we all know about the rest of that after. Yes?
Do you know the way Irish Catholics usually lower their eyes when the host is raised?
Yes, yeah, so they could say that they hadn't seen the Blessed Sacrament. So, well, what we're living through now in the 20th century is we have entire churches that are different, not ethnic groups, but churches which are now in expansion because they're being exterminated in their homelands in the Middle East. And that's why when we refer to the Maronites overseas, outside the patriarchal traditional territories, Cyprus, Crete, Jordan, Israel, Syria, Egypt, when we refer to those places now, we refer to it as the expansion. The reason why I'm bringing this up is because this Orientale Lumen in May 2nd, 1995, is dealing with the question by the end of the 20th century of all of these Eastern churches. In the 1990s, also Rome fosters and encourages and has the development of what we call the Eastern Code of Canon Law. So all of the canons that refer to the Eastern churches, they tried to form a code in parallel that the Roman Church has, but reflecting all of the Eastern traditions, if you like, as a common denominator among the Eastern churches. So you're living in a very unique period of time. And these churches, for the most part, will survive only if they survive in the expansion, sadly. Because right now, you're just basically exterminating everyone in the homeland. And in Lebanon, also, the problem is demographics. They've decided for the last 50 years they all had two children, and the Muslims continue to have the five that they've always had. And so, demographically, it's going to be very difficult in Lebanon. So, that letter of Pope John Paul II is referring, it's a very beautiful letter, and I highly encourage you to find it online and read it. It's not very long. But it gives you a very nice overview of the commonality of Eastern traditions through their history, through their iconography, through their music, through the catechesis, through scriptures, through the liturgical life which is lived. Okay, so this great importance. So I'd highly recommend it. So I just wanted to point that out. And then we have the bottom of page 11. So, talking about our leading us into what's going to be the rest of the book in this description of the Syriac Maronite Catholic faith. So here, as he's got it written down, Catholic faith, Syriac Maronite style. Now, of course, he uses these terms, and these are terms which you really should, you know, have down pat. I know that when I first used the word rozo 2 years ago, everyone looked at me a little confused. Well, no, they looked at me a lot confused. So the Cordobono, and if I change the term, what I love are the purists who go, when you refer to Mass, which of course is just our English vocabulary for referring to the Eucharist, but you get the purists saying, we don't offer Mass. I had someone say to me once, we don't offer Mass. And then I must have looked really confused, and they said, we offer the liturgy. And I thought, well, if that isn't the stupidest thing I've ever heard, because liturgy is a Greek word. If you don't want to use the word that comes from the Latin, essentially, which is why the Latin Roman Catholics refer to it as Mass, then why are you going to use a Greek word for it? That has no more similarity. It just sounds more Eastern, I suppose. But we're not Byzantines. You talk to the Chaldeans and that, they will refer to their liturgy as being the Korban. A lot of times it'll be spelled, it's spelled in a number of different ways, but a lot of times they'll just refer to the Korban. And Korban, Korbono just means offering in Syria. And so of course, I'm trying to use the a bit closer if you want to the Syria with Korbono. It's spelled different ways, but the Cordobono just means offering. And so its proper title is the divine offering. And so you have Alohoyo in front of it. Alohoyo Kurabono. Sometimes with an H at the end, sometimes with no H at the end. Alright? Aloho is God. Alohoyo, you make an adjective out of it, so it becomes the godly or the divine offering. Alohoyo Kurabono. Plural, Alohoye Kurabone. Not real complicated. And so that's what we've used for the terms that we have in the bulletin. And it would be nice to see our community develop our vocabulary. Okay? And so refer to it as, you know, if you don't want to say korbono, refer to it as being the korban, I don't care. But that's also very much closer. Then you can be snooty if you want. But if you're not going to get it right, don't be snooty. All right, just say mass. Okay? But even mass, you know, even the Roman Catholics are moving towards liturgy. Liturgy just means a public work. That's all it means. It's just the combination of ergia for work, which are related to our word energy, and laos, people. So the work of the people are the public work. So liturgy would have been in classical Greece things like garbage collection, public works. So it became the public work was the body of Christ offering the Eucharist. So they just took the word liturgy, which was around there, liturgia, and they place it into a divine sense of the sacraments. Okay? So you can have fun with these things. All right. So he refers to it here because, of course, like with all of the Catholic churches, the Eucharist is the very center of its existence. And it's one of those things that makes it most close to understand when we talk about the fact that Orthodoxy and Catholicism have retained. Catholicism, Roman Catholicism, a little bit less now, because we've mentioned before, we've talked about the two-edged sword, the intellectual or theological approach in the sense of rational arguments in that, it's a two-edged sword. And in Roman Catholicism, it's very easily called into an idea of belief distinct from practice. And so you can have people who never practice and consider themselves still good Catholics. No one in the East would ever have that idea. You'd still call yourself a Christian, but you wouldn't say you're good because you never go to the divine services. And so, in the classical sense of Christianity, it is a lived reality. You live this reality. And so, of course, for all of them, the center of that living is, of course, Jesus present within the Eucharist. It's the very central thing. So, you'll notice the next term they use here in the divine office, and I've often from the pulpit make reference to the divine offices. Now, it's gone through streamlining in the last 50 years, and so our two major offices that remain are the two which are mentioned here, Ramsho and Safro. Ramsho in Syriac just means evening. That's all the word means. So it's the equivalent in the Latin of Vespers. And in Latin, Vespera just means evening. So they've just used the same words for the evening office, Ramsho. And Ramsho in the Syriac tradition is the beginning of the feast. It begins. And the Syriac tradition, that's still very much our part. The Romans decided they were going to find that as a way, in a sense, first Vespers would open your feast day. But the Roman Church was much more focused upon the solar calendar, which is why we have midnight mass at Christmas, which is why we do that, because it was the earliest point you could offer the mass on Christmas, is at midnight. That's how it comes about. The Syriac tradition, being of the Jewish heritage, as you read through the Old Testament, the day begins, evening, morning. Evening, in Genesis, it's described creation, evening, morning, evening, morning. You have this creation. It doesn't say morning, night, morning, night. It's evening. The day begins. And so Shabbat for the Jews today begins on Friday evening and goes until the evening of Saturday. Because the evening of Saturday is the beginning of Sunday. And that's why the Romans then trying to find another way to get you other than coming to Mass on Sunday morning was to say, well, let's do this also if we give them an evening one. So in the late 50s, early 60s, they started having evening Masses on Saturday, on Sunday. I never quite understood why it wasn't sufficient. And then, of course, then after that, we started having the Saturday evening Mass, and well, then after that, we just didn't go to Mass. And so, but the idea behind it was that was the beginning with sundown on Saturday, Ramsho, was the beginning of the day. Okay? So there are residual aspects of that within the Latin rite in the liturgy. Now, the other term which we have is Safro. And Safro, as you probably can guess, in Syriac just means mourning. Sometimes it's spelled with an F, sometimes it's spelled with a PH. I don't know what's in this book, which is it spelled with an F. Yes. Now, in the Latin tradition, the term is laud, which has nothing to do with mourning. It refers to the fact of, at the end of, it's partially psalms, partially hymns, partially scripture readings. If you just read them, they take about a half an hour in the Syriac, Ramsho, and Safro to read. So they're not huge, but they're longer than lauds and vespers. At the end of the psalms, you have 148, 149, and 150, the three last psalms of the Psalter. And the Latins don't do that anymore since the beginning of the 20th century. In Safro, we still finish 148, 149, 150. We still finish with those, and Psalm 116. But because they begin with the term praise God or some kind of form of praise, which in Latin is laudare, then they refer to the morning office as being laudes, the praises, laudes in Latin. And we just drop the S in English for lauds. That's where it comes from, because it refers to the morning praise of these psalms, which is much more in the Latin tradition. The psalms are much more important. They're central. They're the central and essential aspect. Whereas the psalms exist within the Syriac tradition, but they're not the most, they're not the essence of it. The essence of it really is hymns. It's all the poetry. So if you go to our monastery in Petersham, you'll hear them sing all the melodies. They'll sing all of these hymns for when they do the office, because they sing these Safro and Ramsho. Okay? So you have a reference there. And then, and I don't know why he didn't put the italicized word in here, and the sacramental mysteries, or the divine mysteries. And of course, that's that mysterious word, rozo. And so the plural of rozo is rose, just like cordobono, plural, one cordobono, two cordobone. And so rose is the mysteries. And we told you that rozo is an old Persian word. Okay? We mentioned to you before that the term sacrament for the Latins, they're emphasizing the inviolable and the sacred, untouchable ceremony. Because in the Latin, that's the sacramentum. Something which was inviolable among the Romans was referred to as sacramentum. It's set aside. When you got tattooed on your arm when you were in the military for the men, that was sacramentum. You're marked. That's part of the historical origin of us making the sign of the cross for the Latins on the forehead of children at their baptism. It's a sacramentum. You are sealed. The mark, like being in the army of Jesus, like the army of the city of Rome. For us, the marking on the forehead is actually, should historically be more like an X. And it has to do with Hashem, the holy name, and the Tau in Hebrew. But that's a whole different thing. Okay? The word mysterion in the Greek, and we'll talk about that when we get to the sacrament of baptism. The mysterion in Greek is referring to that which is hidden within this ceremony. The mystos, the mystes, is coming from the Elysian mysteries. Eleusis is outside of Athens, probably about a half an hour outside. But it used to be the great pilgrimage from Athens to the place of the mysteries of the goddess of Mother Earth. They were fertility rites. But they never exposed the ceremonies. Later on, the fathers of the church, they start writing about some of it because it's all collapsing. You can still go visit these places. You can go and see the hole in the ground, the cave, the rock formation, where Persephone is supposed to have come out each springtime to bring life back to the earth as she left from Hades to come back, the queen of death. And so this whole notion of fertility, these were the Eleusis, in Eleusis, the Elysian mysteries. They were the ceremonies that were done in these huge halls that were not spoken of. And so mustein in the Greek is to keep your mouth shut, silence. It doesn't refer to the thing itself, it refers to the silence of the appearance. And so the thing that they're being silenced, mustes, about is the mysterion. So what the Greeks did, the Greek Christians, the Hellenic Christians, is they took then that terminology, as they converted to the gospel, they took that terminology to emphasize that hidden divine power that is transmitted through the church, and through especially these great channels. But again, in the Eastern Church, they've never defined seven mysteries, right? The Roman Church has defined seven sacraments because the Protestants were denying like all of them. And so you guys said, no, these are the seven fundamental and primordial transmissions of the life of Christ to the baptized. And so you came up, you had the seven. It always had been taught, but you had to make it an official dogmatic statement at the Council of Trent, because the Protestants were ripping everything apart. And that's why the Council of Trent did so much. What are the books of the Bible? These. It's only defined with silver trumpets and magisterial, fulminations, of thunder and lightning, because the Protestants are ripping the Bible apart. We're throwing out this, taking out this book, and you're like, ah! Yeah. And so you define what books belong to this collection. They're like, ah! None of these things, they don't even transfer what you call grace. Grace is based upon just you and Jesus as your Lord and Savior and your act of faith. These ceremonies don't do anything except provoke, they make you feel pious. And because you feel pious, Jesus does his stuff in you. It has nothing to do with the ceremonies. So they deny any intrinsic value to the mysteries, and subsequently just wind up denying the mysteries altogether and leave you with baptism and some form of interpretation of what we call the Eucharist. And that's it. So the Council of Trent was like horrified by all of this, and so defined these seven, which all of the apostolic churches adhere to. They all accept these as being. But they don't really feel a need to specify all of these pointed details. The Roman Catholic Church looks the way it does because of the Protestant Revolution. That's why the Roman Catholics look so different from the other ancient apostolic churches. In essence, they have the same faith, but they look quite different. Because they've had to, not only because they have a tendency, and the Roman tendency is to pinpoint and make precise and order things, Rome. But also because the Protestants came in and just went in the 1500s, and then it's like, well, okay, we really have to make this dogmatically clear as being the official doctrine of Christianity. Yes?
All the real diehard Protestants that Larry and I know give us grief about our elevation of the Blessed Mother. Where's the division?
We'll get
with
to
it?
That eventually. We're not going off on like that.
That's
we'll
a big deal.
That's the question.
You go on tangents all the time.
No, but tangents are wonderful. That's why the class is great, because you can't go on tangents during a sermon. I don't understand, so you just go.
Well, I just had that conversation with somebody else.
Yeah, it's
so
great.
So we'll get to it.
Okay.
And part of it will be this Sunday sermon, because we have the May crowning, and so it should be part of it.
Well, thank you, because a lot of us get grief for this.
Yeah.
It's a teaser.
So that's why the Roman Church insists upon the seven sacraments, because they define the primordial, fundamental. You'll see the icons or the mosaics in Rome, which are centuries older than the Council of Trent, and you see the seven rivers flowing out from underneath the Lamb and the Apostles standing. You see that in San Clemente. And of course, those are the seven primordial rivers of life that flow from the death and resurrection of our Lord. We call them the sacraments of the Latin tradition. But they never become, inscribed in stone, because everyone just believes it. It's there until we have the Protestant Revolution. That's also why the Eastern churches also were quite easy on putting everything in the vernacular. It didn't really matter to them using the vernacular. They always kept some things in the ancient languages to show the continuity of the tradition. But the Roman church didn't do that, and then when it did do it, it was like popping open and the whole thing just sprang all over the place. But the reason why they didn't do that in the 1500s, because by the 16th century, most of the Eastern rites had been already shifting to the vernacular, because no one was speaking Syriac anymore. Nobody was speaking old, what's now called Church Slavonic. It's an ancient form of Slavonic, which they're not spoken anymore. And so you started moving in that way. But the reason why the Latin church didn't do it officially, like everyone else was doing, again, was because of the Protestant Revolution. Because these Germans were using vernacular, or Italians, or whoever else was, they were using the vernacular as a conveyance of their own heretical or heterodox ideas. And so Rome said, never, we're not translating anything from the Latin. You keep using the Latin text because it's certain, it's the tradition that has been given to us, it is the faith of our fathers. This is the integrity of the sacred mysteries that we have been given, and so you hold on. And that's why in Europe it became nothing will be translated from Latin. And until the 20th century, you're even doing the readings in Latin because they changed nothing because of the vehicle of revolution that it had become for the Protestants. And I bring this up because in 1588, Rome, 1500s, right, same period of time, when the Council of Trent and Rome was not going to budge on translating the Mass in Europe, they authorized the Jesuits in China to translate the entire thing from start to finish, all the mysteries, the entire Mass, start to finish, into Mandarin. And you have missals with big Mandarin characters. This is my, you know, you have these, but they never used them, even though they printed the books and got ready for it, because the Franciscans and the Dominicans in China were like having meltdowns. Because the Jesuits were there trying to make Catholicism a Chinese thing that the Chinese would recognize. And the Franciscans and the Dominicans are like freaking out because you're paganizing Christianity. So you have one of the complaints, some of them were petty, some of them were bigger, but you get one of the petty ones as an example is the Franciscans were upset that the crucifixion scenes in the Jesuit churches, the Blessed Virgin Mary and St. John and all the rest, they all had shoes on. And the Jesuits trying to explain, even your hands were considered unclean for the Chinese. Bare feet are considered obscene. You would never in a sacred setting have toes looking at you from over the sacred altar. That just didn't make any sense. For the Chinese also, to approach the divinity, you always covered your head. The idea of appearing before the divinity with your head uncovered was to them just absolutely unimaginable. So the Jesuits developed this kind of beretta mitre thing that they would wear during the Mass to have their head covered for the Chinese converts would recognize the sacredness and the idea before the divinity. Well, they didn't like that either. And so there were a number of these things that went on. And if you go to the Jesuit cemetery with three of the first great Chinese Jesuit missions, it's in the middle of Beijing. You can visit it. It's in the middle of the Communist Party's College of Economics. And they've preserved it. You can, I've been there. You can go to the cemetery that they have preserved in the middle. And during the Boxers' Rebellion in the early 1900s, when all of these people were being martyred all over, and Shanghai, all the Christian cemeteries were destroyed. It wasn't destroyed in Beijing. It wasn't Peking at the time. It wasn't destroyed in Beijing because they protected it. It was inside what had been part of the French school grounds, and so they protected these during these. So you can go and find the original 16th century headstones, and they are glorious things. They are these huge stones that go up. They are completely Chinese. So on top of them, you have clouds and dragon figures, and then crosses in the middle of it. And then one sign is all the inscription in Latin, and the other side is the inscription in Chinese of these headstones of these Catholic priests who are buried in this area of the original Jesuit mission. It's absolutely glorious. So the Jesuits never implemented the use of Mandarin because they were having too many fights, internecine fights with their confreres in the other orders. And so rather than going on with this, they just simply never implemented the actual permission and authorization. Did the same thing, a parallel done in India the following century, in the 18th century, was being done by Father De Nobili, another Italian, but he wanted in India, he was going to translate everything into Sanskrit. He is the first European that we know of who learned the sacred language of Sanskrit from the Brahmins, because he won their confidence. You know, you didn't go to Barnes & Noble and buy, you know, Sanskrit for Dummies book and just study it. No, you had to be orally taught the Sanskrit to read the text. And following what the Jesuits had done in China, he wanted to do the same thing in the following century. But again, that wasn't... He was so successful, he wanted to, his immediate disciples, his students, were martyred by the Brahmin priest. Because they were there for thousands of Indians. Yes?
I'm just kind of wondering about the continuity between insisting that the Mass remain in Latin while still having the Douay-Rheims translation in the late 1400s into English.
But it was never, but you know, you have, what you read, what you call Douay-Rheims now, is actually the Challoner edition from the 18th century. If you can find the text of the actual Douay, it would be almost incomprehensible. Well, it's not incomprehensible, it's modern English, but it's like the difficulties of reading Shakespearean English, which is also considered modern English. If you find the original Douay translation, it's clumsy. And so Challoner in the 18th century, 200 years later, he does an updated version, which to our ears sounds still outmoded. Mm-hmm. And so that's why 200 years after Challoner, the CCD, the Confraternity of Christian Doctrine, sponsored a new translation in the 1950s. And that's the CCD translation, which is basically an updating of what originally was called the Douay-Rheims.
But it was still translating the Bible into the, into the vulgar.
Into the vernacular. So they're still basically using a translation of the Vulgate Latin text with a heavy influence from the Greek. All right, so now we come to Rozo. As we mentioned to you, Rozo is this ancient Persian word referring to the mandates or the dictates of the Shahan Shah, the King of Kings. All right? So the imperial decrees, the manifestation of the will of the Shah, was Rozo. These were the imperial mandates, the imperial decrees. And so the people of the Middle East, simply then using these as the primordial directive source of life of the King of Heaven, right, it made perfect sense that they used the term for the sacrament, we call the sacraments now. So what you see is that the sacrament refers to the inviolable ceremony. Mystery is emphasizing the internal sanctifying reality of grace. And Rozo is emphasizing that this is the divine will being manifested to us. So if you understand the nuance of each of them, then use them in their nuance on what you want to do. But in our tradition, we call them Rose, right? The Holy Rose, the divine mandates, the divine decrees, or the divine counsels. These are the things that the divine king manifests to us. And that's why in the scriptures, when we say our Lord is King of Kings and Lord of Lords, well, King of Kings is Shahan Shah. That was the name given to the Persian emperor. Right? It just means the greatest king in the Aramaic languages. Right? King of Kings, Lord of Lords, it means the greatest king and the greatest lord. That's why we have the Song of Songs, the Canticle of Canticles in the Old Testament, the book. It just means the greatest song ever written. That's what it's called. And so, but you don't have that in Semitic, because they don't have superlative and comparative in the changing of their adjectives. You juxtapose. So you have King of Kings. And so Rozo is a very beautiful term, and I would love it to see our people eventually start using them quite naturally. We use sacrament and we use Mass because we speak English, and the English Catholic world is predominantly influenced by Latin Catholicism. And there's nothing wrong with their terms. Right? But I think you could have, by knowing the proper meaning of these terms, you could have a lot of fun over coffee making your other Roman Catholic friends kind of like spin in circles, because you can just give these different nuances of these primordial channels of life that come from the death and resurrection of our Lord. So these are the things that we work on, and that's why we have the class, because you can ask these questions, and then we keep moving. So that's why, so he mentions the sacramental mysteries or the sacramental rosae. Okay? Let's take our little bit of break now, because when we come back, I'm going to talk about more at length of the Husoyo at the bottom of the page, because that is completely central to the Syriac tradition of Christianity, and it is unique to the Syriac tradition. Okay? We'll spend more time on it in the second half. Caffeine.
Oh, they made some decaf, I believe.
I need the taste of coffee.
All right, here we go. Now you're going to have some scripture references also. You ready?
It's just finishing.
Margaret May, come back in. And, oh, there you are. Walk in front of the camera now.
Why?
Because you're always too late to walk right in front of the camera. Your ears are famous on YouTube. So before we start the next segment, come down and walk through it already.
There's my ears.
There you go. Okay. Bottom of page 11 now in the introduction. Now, we have the Husoyo. And we've talked about this numerous times. And again, see in Syriac, this O ending is actually the equivalent of the. So it's actually Husoyo, in what's called the absolute form. Okay? It's not a big deal, but it's when you saw that on Easter, I put on the bell, on the bulletin, Pescho. That's our name for the resurrection, Pescho. But remember, we talked about that in Hebrew, the word for Pascha.
Which one? What you said about the resurrection.
Pescho.
Go for it, poor father, we're going to be right.
It's a bit of an aside, but it's when we had, on the front of the bulletin, we wrote Pescho in my really cool font called Jana.
That was a nice font. Very lovely font.
So the absolute form of it is Pesch.
Oh, just ancient.
Pesch. But remember I told you when we were doing the section earlier, I told you that the word for Passover in Hebrew was Pesach. So Pesach, in the Syriac it's Pesch. Pesach. It's the same word. When you say Pescho, it means the Passover. So the same way in French that they've taken Pesach and over the years it became Pascha in Greek and then it became Pascha in Latin, they just simply moved it over from the Greek. And then Pascha became in French Pâques. That's why you have a little circumference over the A, because it's telling you the S of Pascha has disappeared. And so you have a little hat over the A, the circumflex. And the other leg, so Pascua in Italian or Pascha in the other languages, they're all using what originally is the Hebrew word, just being transliterated in these forms. But of course in Syriac, they're already cousins, and so the word for the Passover is Pesach, or Pescho, meaning the Passover. Okay? And so that's actually our proper term for Easter. I would love to see us move away from Easter because that is a Germanic pagan word for the goddess of fertility in the springtime.
Yes.
I really don't like it. Easter is related to our word East. That's why Austrian German is called East Österreich. It's the Eastern Kingdom. You know, and if you're a German in the middle of Germany, it is east of you. So Austria is the Österreich is the Eastern Kingdom, the Eastern Empire. And so, but Erster, she's the Eastern fertility goddess. And I just, the term is fine and everybody understands it, but again, you know, I don't understand why, later for 1,500 years we were Christians, why we didn't get rid of these terms, why we still refer to the middle of the week as being the day of Woden. I have no idea. Because in the Christian, in the Catholic countries, they just number the days. They just simply number them, but they've also, in France, they've kept them, you know. Monday is Lundi, it's the day of the moon. Why all these Germanic pagan gods hung around in these names, it's just beyond me. So that's why I talk a lot about the words, because words are communication. So now, for example, in German, you know, throughout Europe, you have a whole youth movement of a return to paganism. It's very, very popular. But, you know, we never shook off even the remnants of a lot of our pagan references, and Easter being one of them. Again, we never picked up a term. We picked it up for things that are distinctly Christian, like church. And we've talked about that. The German and the Germanic languages just took it from Kyriake, or Kyriako, what belongs to the Lord, Kyrios. And so Kyrios, Kyriake became Kyrke, Church, church. That's where it comes from in the Germanic languages. But that's why in the front of the bulletin, I put down Pesco. But I hesitated because I was trying to think of a way to do the notation so you wouldn't say Pesh. Okay? Right. Which, of course, without the S in French is just fish. You know, or fishing, Peshe. It also means to sin, Peshe. Depends on how it's written. But Peshe is to sin because Peshe became the word from peccatum in Latin. So peccatum became Peshe. So anyways. Peshe is to sin and sin, but also, you know, piscatore is, you know, fishing. Anyway, so, who saw you? Now, we've talked about this. I'm going to give you scripture references to where this is coming from. And again, so, who saw you? Or who saw you? The who saw you. Okay? I mean, if we don't do this, how are you ever going to be ready in another 2 years to be able to recite the Abunda Bashmayo liturgy on Sunday? So you've got to be able to, on Sundays you'll have to sing the Our Father in Syriac. It'll be very impressive to all of your cousins when they visit or your friends. So, and all of a sudden the whole church just burst into Abunda Bashmayo. Yes.
When we had the nuns visiting for our retreat, were they singing the Our Father in, what language were they singing? Because they talked about getting it for us, copies for us, and it just kind of fell apart.
I didn't say that on the conferences, but I would assume they're saying it in Syriac.
They were.
There's no reason for us to say it in Arabic, because we don't. It's a vernacular language. That's like, you know, we take a vote. Who wants to learn it in Ukrainian? Who wants to learn it in German? It doesn't make any sense, because even though our parents may have had a connection with Arabic, and some spoke Arabic while they were still at home, nobody in the parish actually speaks Arabic as their language any longer. But to learn the liturgical or the traditional language of antiquity, that's why all of the Eastern rites, even, you know, the Ukrainians have parts of their liturgy. They'll do it in modern Ukrainian or they'll do it in English, but they'll keep certain parts in the old Slavonic being spoken by the ancient Ukrainians, or who we call Ukrainians now. It's always the argument, who are these people? The Rus. It's like asking the question, what's an Arab, right? What's a Rus? Is the same kind of launches, the same kind of minefields of argumentation as asking a Middle Easterner, what's an Arab?
Okay. Because we talked to Sister Marla about it, and she was going to send us something. It was beautiful. Whatever they sang, it was absolutely breathtaking.
In Arabic. I mean, all three of those women are fluent in Arabic because they come from a very different Maronite culture in Australia, where, you know, second and third generation born Australians are still living in this ghetto where they're still speaking Arabic at home. So they have formed a complete enclave internal to themselves. So no one just, I mean, I suppose some people might show up, but for the most part, their liturgies are all in Arabic and Syriac still. And so they do, obviously, they do some English. But it meant that all those ladies grew up speaking Arabic at home. They all speak Arabic. That's why when they went to Lebanon this summer, they went as part of an apostolic work. I mean, they were giving retreats and working with some of the girls' schools and that were over in Lebanon. And so they may have been in Arabic, I don't know. But I would guess, because they're really keen on Syriac, you know. Because even when you look at the red books, at the same time that you're going to learn the Abunda Bashmayo, I'm going to introduce more of that Syriac text that's on the far right of the book. That's my part, you know. So, you know, because it's there. I mean, that's actually one of the questions I asked before I even decided to become a Maronite. I said, looking in this missal, there is a lot more Syriac in this book than we are using. I said, is it all right to use them? And I said, of course it is. But that's my responsibility, right? The whole fraction is in Syriac, right? So those are different questions. And that's why we're using a lot. Well, one, because I also think one of the easiest ways to understand things is to talk about the terms you're using. That's one reason why I always do words. But also because I do want you to move towards what's properly our historical repertoire as a church. So you'll see, for example, on the online, a very nice article that was done with Harvest Magazine on the luncheon that we had. But you'll see that we were referred to as being the Maronite Rite. We're not a Maronite Rite, we are a Maronite Church, and because we're a Maronite Church, we happen to have a rite that is also called Maronite. Right? Nobody refers to the Roman Catholic Church as being just simply the Roman Rite.
Latin Rite.
Yeah, it's a Latin Rite, properly speaking. Okay? So it's little details like that, it's proper to understand, especially as Easterners. And then, so someone said to me, well, isn't that all just petty? And I went, well, no, it's not, because it's the understanding of the church. You know, Vatican II had all kinds of hiccups at the beginning of it, because they were still continuing the old tradition where all of the cardinals outranked all of the patriarchs. And the patriarchs arrived there, and they're like, no, we're not getting in front of the procession in front of them. Because the cardinals are clergy of the city of Rome. Most of them are cardinal priests. Their titles are priests within the city of Rome. Yeah, they're cardinals. But the Latin church developed this, the cardinals have like universal jurisdiction, practically, because they're part of the Pope's council. And so, at the beginning of Vatican II, the patriarchs like, we're not just going to sit with other bishops, we're not bishops, we are heads of churches. We are patriarchs. And patriarch is not just a fancy title that you give to just some random bishop because you want to honor him. It is a very specific notion of ecclesiastical paternity for an entire church of people. Now, in the Latin tradition, they just kind of scratch their head and they don't understand. Because, you know, they had honorific patriarchs. You had the Patriarch of Goa, you know. You had the Patriarch of Lisbon. And those were titles that were given to the Portuguese because they had expanded so far out first, even before the Spanish, taking the gospel out to Asia. So you had the patriarchs. So they gave them these honorifics. But they were only honorific, and everybody knew that because the patriarch of the Latin church is the Pope. Can't have two patriarchs of one church. You gave these honorific titles. So the Roman Catholics just thought, well, patriarch is just an honorific thing that you give. And so these guys are from the East, and you want to kind of smooth out their vanity, so you call them patriarchs. And they're like, no. And so the person who said to me, well, isn't this like hair splitting? And I said, no, because it's the ecclesiastical vision of how the Church of Christ works. And eventually, these patriarchs, you know, they weren't going to get in this line where you're putting them because you're making them inferior to some cardinal priest or cardinal deacon behind them. Some of the titles of cardinals are diaconates. Some of them are priests. There's only six who are bishops. Everybody else is a, you know, of the original 72 classic number, 50 of them are cardinal priests. Six of them are cardinal bishops, and the rest of them are cardinal deacons. And so their position in the city of Rome, in the diocese of Rome, is as a deacon. Or as a priest. And they're saying, I'm a patriarch. I'm the head of a church. You don't put... And so there was all this controversy at the beginning of Vatican II, and eventually they made a special table towards the front where those presiding over the council sat, so the patriarchs would have their own place. And I think they even put one or two of the patriarchs on the presiding council. Right? So someone says, well, that's just petty and it's vain. It's not vanity. It's a vision of how the Church of Christ works. So we are not just a Maronite rite. We are a Maronite church sui generis, and that's going to come up in the next pages. Okay, now, we go back to this husoio. Okay? Because this is the central part of our Syriac tradition. No other Christian church celebrates husoio except the Syriac tradition. Which is why when I arrived here and I got these questions like, you don't use incense every day?
Yeah.
It's like, yeah, it's the center of what we do. But I understood the question, because in a lot of our parishes we don't. And it's like, well, it just makes it faster if you just read the thing and move on. But of course at that point the prayer doesn't mean anything, because every single time the end of the husoio means perfume. And it always makes reference to receive our incense before you. And if you never do incense and you just read it, it doesn't really make any sense. So this, so what is this central thing? So, talking about the husoyo. Right. Now here you have at the bottom of the page, we have, in English we will call it the prayer of forgiveness. But what the term actually means is propitiation. One of our families came back, they were down part of the snowbirds in Florida, and they came back and they said, when we were in Florida, we went to a Russian Orthodox church. And I said, okay. I said, it was beautiful. Yeah. I said, yeah, it was also long, right? They said, yeah, 2.5 hours. And so, but they were saying that, you know, the Byzantine rite, you can't see the iconostasis at a certain moment because there's just so much incense filling this place because they're just always using it. I mean, our principal point is the husoyo. But so this person was going on about this, how, you know, and it was provoking some of the other ladies working in the kitchen because some of them have a Melkite background. And the Melkites, of course, are Byzantine. So, you know, our ceremonies will look stripped down if you're used to a Byzantine ceremony. All right? Plus, you know, I guess there's not a lot of asthmatics among the Byzantines.
And yeah, if they do,
they must stand outside or something. So the word husoyo, what is translated here as the prayer of forgiveness, means propitiation. And the first reference is to the letter of the letter to the Hebrews, all right? Chapter 9, verses 1 through 5. I've mentioned about this in a sermon before, because it gives us an understanding of the scriptural and the Semitic background behind it. So chapter 9, verses 1 through 5. The former indeed has also justifications, divine service, and a worldly sanctuary. He's referring to the old law. They have a temple, there's a building, a worldly sanctuary. For there was a tabernacle, a tent, made the first, wherein the seven-branched lampstand and the table and the setting forth of loaves, which are called holy. They would put the seven, what we call pita, right? The seven flatbreads out. 12 flatbreads representing the 12 tribes. You put down four, you put incense down on top, you put down another four, and you stack these. This is the ceremony, the incense ceremony in the beginning of the day, the morning, that Zachary was doing when the angel Gabriel appeared to him. Right? So he's talking about the breads that are offered in front. And they were offered in front of the inside veil in front of the Holy of Holies. So remember, there's two sections to the tabernacle. There's two sections to the tent in Jerusalem. The first place is the holy place, which becomes the equivalent of our bima, the first platform, which is why we have two entrances. And the second curtain was to the Holy of Holies. That's where the Ark of the Covenant was. So nobody ever saw it. Not even the priest officiating would ever have seen the ark, except for the high priest, and only once a year. So even the priest didn't see the ark. All right? So in front of this curtain, though, because the ark was behind the second curtain, when our Lord is crucified, the rending of the veil, the curtain that's torn, is not the front one, it's the one that is the Holy of Holies that's torn from the top down. So in front of this veil, you had a table, a golden table, and these breads were put out every single day and then taken away at night, and 12 fresh loaves of bread were brought out because it represented the 12 tribes of Israel. It's the equivalent of why we burn a candle in front of the altar. It's not about the Blessed Sacrament. It's about us being present in front of the altar. Which is why the candle is supposed to be in front of the altar and not behind it or beside it. You often see it next to it, but technically, according to the canons, it's supposed to be in front of it because it represents us.
Yes. Do you mean the red candle that's high up on the right?
Yeah.
I was always taught that if the Eucharist was present...
Everybody says that.
And that's not true?
No. It represents us. You always keep it burning because it's not about Jesus' presence, it's about our presence. You go into any Eastern church, you got candles burning all over the place in front of altars because they're about the equivalent of our... So what we do with our votive candles, and eventually we will have real candles here because this idea of these little... Anyway, we never got a piece, we never got a slab of marble from the Ursulines, did we?
Did we? No.
Well, because we were going to put marble down underneath so that we'd have, you know, a solid, you know, non-flammable surface to put the candles. But anyway, that's a different question. But the way you light a votive candle in front of an icon or a statue or something, that's you, right? That's you praying, and then you go off for coffee and donuts. But your presence in front of this image, or whatever it is. I mean, when I was in Fall River, we used to have, you know, racks of eight-day candles, you know, and you'd have big candles burning for a week and a half in front of the icons. Right? There they were all electric. You just pushed a button and it started flickering. I like candles. I like the smell of burning wax. I like when you walk into a Catholic church, it smells, it's penetrated by incense and the smell of wax. Not paraffin, wax. The candles that are on the main altar now are 100% beeswax. Nice. Right? They burn a bit slower, they're more expensive, but they also burn longer. Anyway, so the votive candle, what we do, right, even the popping the button on the bottom one, is representing us in front of here, the Blessed Virgin Mary. The parish presence before the Holy of Holies is represented by the big candle that burns all the time. Yeah, all kinds of devotional books will say, oh, the little red lamp which tells us that Jesus is locked in his mouth.
Well, that's it. I mean, generations of people have taught that.
Yes, and it's all very pious, but it's not actually the canonical tradition.
Wow.
I mean, do you remember about 5 or 6 years ago there was a big fight in Jerusalem? They were even swinging thuribles at each other in the Church of the Resurrection?
No.
Does anyone remember this? It was in the news.
No.
I was in Geneva at the time, so it had to be anywhere between 2007, 2011, somewhere around there. Some big fight broke out, transmitted. I remember hearing it on the news, and I was thinking, yes, they're being very traditional, because that's what you've always done. Because all of the altars in the Church of the Resurrection, even if it was built by Latin crusaders, the church is controlled by the Greek Orthodox, because the Sultan, the Ottoman Sultan, handed over to the Greeks to control of. And so between the Roman Catholics and the Greek Orthodox, you alternate days of the week. The Orthodox get 4 days, and the Roman Catholics, the Catholics get 3 days a week in the Anastasis, the slab where our Lord's body laid for the resurrection. You say Mass in there. 4 days of the week are reserved to the Orthodox churches, and 3 days. And if you're a non-Chalcedonian church, too bad. So the Ethiopians squatted the back of the Anastasis, and they built like a tent back there, and they keep an Ethiopian priest in there all the time, because he's a squatter, right? And they built a little shrine and put an altar in there, so that's where they offer their masses. And what was funny is, you know, when they just rebuilt that whole Anastasis, the Epicure they call it?
Yeah.
So when they rebuilt it in these last few years, that was after the negotiations, I think even decades, before everybody who's in that building would agree on having it rebuilt and the terms behind it. So Father Jordan, who you all remember, he was telling me one of the things, for example, that was a sticking part is the Ethiopians, who are squatters at the back of this little building, they wanted water. They wanted a pipe of water to be run back there before they give their agreement to rebuilding this little building. And the Orthodox and the Latins were like, well, no, because you're not even supposed to be there in the first place. Because the priest is always there. So someone has to be there, because if you leave, there's no one at this altar. Quick, rip it down. Now, over the centuries, they'd pull it down and pull the pieces away someplace. You have, like, I don't know if they're Romanian Orthodox or what. They have built on the outside of the church residences. And then they punch a hole to like the second story of the church so they can get into the church, because they have an outside source to get in. And because of all this fighting among the different Christian peoples in this building over the centuries, it's why the Ottoman sultans gave the keys to the building to a Muslim family. So every day, like at 4 o'clock in the morning when this building is open, it's a Muslim family who by tradition are the doorkeepers. And there's a ceremony every day in which the doors are locked from the outside and you get locked into the building. Now, if you go to Jerusalem, you can petition to be one of the people with the Latin priest inside, because the Franciscans are in there, to spend the night at the holy spot. You can do that, but you can't go out during the night because the doors are locked, right? This is not, you know, OSHA, panic door buttons, you know. And there's a whole ceremony in the morning also of how the Muslims open these doors. So a few years ago, you had a fight break out. The fight was over the presence of altars. If you go to Calvary, if you Google Calvary, and you'll see this huge icon of our Lord crucified, and there's a square Orthodox altar over the top. You can go down underneath the altar, and you can put your hand into the stone where the cross was, okay, on Calvary. There is always an Orthodox priest standing there for the presence of the Orthodox. But what you also will see is the entire ceiling is filled with hanging candles, votive lamps. They're not all lit because it's a pain in the butt to keep all of these wicks burning. Because that lamp that's in front of the altar is supposed to be an oil lamp with a floating wick in it. So if you've been to the Orthodox churches, you see all those lamps in front of the icons on the iconostasis. Technically, I mean, now they're making them electric, but technically they're all oil. And at the end of each year, so at Easter time, when the new sacred oils are given to the parish, to the priest, the old oils are supposed to be burned in those lamps. But when I was at the seminary in Switzerland, we had an oil burning lamp on the altar and a little cork floating boat, and we change the wick every morning, and then the thing flips over and it goes out and the wick sinks to the bottom of this oil and you just get a mess. So now you just put a wax candle in it. But it symbolizes our presence. And so those Orthodox wanted to make sure you knew this is our place. And they don't allow anyone to offer Mass on Calvary except the Greek Orthodox or Orthodox in communion with them. So the Catholics built an altar right next to it, Our Lady of Sorrows, right? So it's supposed to be the 13th station, right? It's like, so you have this thing in here. And it had to have been Italians because inside this glass box, there is this wax image, right, you know, anathema to all Eastern churches to make all these statues. And they built this statue, this wax image of Our Lady of Sorrows, and it's draped in purple and black, and there's tears coming down, and then there's pearl earrings, and then there's like rings on all of the fingers because pilgrims come and they give donations. And so this statue, the statue looks like one of those in the amusement parks, the gypsy fortune teller you put in the little park, because it's behind this box and there's like rings all over and there's watches and bracelets, and then the rest of it all around the bottom of this bust statue is all of like this gold jewelry. I mean, I understand why they're doing it, but it's extraordinary. It's absolutely extraordinary. And so that's like right next to it. So what happens is your lamp indicates your presence there. And if your lamp goes out, you're basically renouncing. And if someone gets to your altar. And then, of course, every afternoon at 3, the Franciscans do a procession through the Basilica. All right? And the Latins they've built an entire chapel onto the side of the Crusader Church. It's the Church of the Resurrection, attached to it. And there they have adoration of the Blessed Sacrament, they do all the Latin masses in there, and the Franciscans come in and out for that. But of course, you know, Father Jordan plays organ, right? So he's telling me they were thrilled, because he says, I can't see that procession at all, because it's in the main church. And he's just out there wailing away at this organ, filling the entire basilica, this ancient building, with this loud Latin hymns, and they still sing them in Latin. And you know, because when I was there for one of these things, there were about 15 seminarians we had gone to the Holy Land. So it was 1988. And the Franciscans were all really excited because, you know, they're usually, you know, like 10 of them. So now all of a sudden, they're going to be like 25 of us in this procession at 3 p.m., right? And of course, there's some hymns, and you know, we were all doing the old Latin tradition stuff, so this book is fine for us. We read all the Gregorian chant and everything. No problem. So the Franciscans were doubly thrilled. They're like, you guys are going to be great. And we're all in cassocks and surplice. This is even better. Father Jordan was telling me, you get these priests showing up at the most sacred place in the world, and they're in flip-flops and shorts.
Oh, what?
And they throw an alb over the top, and it's all, when one of the priests that I know in South Jersey, he shows up, and he's a knight of the Holy Sepulchre. So he shows up, and he's got his mozzetta on, with the Jerusalem cross, and his ribbon, and of course, he always wears his cassock. The parish that he's at, down in South Jersey, and I think Diocese of Camden, they do everything in the old, it's a whole parish done of all the Latin ancient rites. So he shows up with the pilgrims. He's already in his cassock, and he's always in the cassock. The Franciscans are like, whew. They have a Franciscan priest who's in the sacristy just to monitor all the sacred vessels coming back, because there are priests who do not believe that there is a Eucharistic presence, substantial presence, once the Eucharist is done. So they just bring back what they consider to be altar breads. So the Franciscans are in there trying to make sure they go through all the sacred vessels that come back to the main sacristy of all these Roman Catholic priests to make sure there's no sacrilege going on and everything is purified. So that's what one priest's job is. And I knew about that before Father Jordan told me. But so we get there and we go through here. This gives you an idea how this works. This is back in the 80s. So you do a procession and all these side altars around. And what the Orthodox did is they built walls up because you have arches around the old sanctuary that were all open to let light in. Well, they just bricked them all up. So it's like walking through a tunnel because there's no light that goes to the rest of the church because they blocked off all of what would normally, you know, like in the cathedral, like when Notre Dame burned, you have that upper story, which are the windows that let light into the church. But if you brick up all of the sanctuary, all of the ambulatory that goes around the outside of that altar now don't get any natural light. So it's like walking through a tunnel. But those are the altars, like in the back corner, there's a place where you have a fragment of the column of our Lord scourging, it's there. And so they have a whole itinerary of this little black book that you sing all the hymns and make this devotion in honor of our Lord's death at 3 p.m. every day they do this. And so we get around to that back place, and all of a sudden, I don't know if they're Greeks or Romanians or Bulgarians or what, some Orthodox groups decides they're going to start doing their devotion at the slab of the anointing. And they are clearly trying to out-sing us. And to be louder than us singing whatever Greek hymn or whatever they're doing.
Amazing.
All right, so this is the beauty of the living tradition of Jerusalem. So I think that the Ethiopians in the back, or the Copts have done that. The Ethiopians are on the roof of the building. They're on the roof of the building. That's how they've occupied their spot. So we get back and we start singing this hymn and kneeling down and doing devotions and this prayer. And then the Franciscan priest who's leading it in his habit and surplice and stole it. He's reading the prayer at the end. Everything's in Latin. Fine. So they're singing whatever's going on down here. Now, of course, because this is also like a tunnel, it's like an echo chamber. So we get up from the column of the scourging, and these guys have been trying to drown us out, and there's like 8 of them, right? But doing, you know, a cappella Greek chants, you know, booming voices, they're pretty good. But the next hymn is the Vexillarages, and the Vexillarages is like one of our favorites. So it's this magnificent hymn, Vexillarages. Vexilla is your battle standard. Oh. It's the image of the Latin church uses of the cross. Lift now the battle standard of the king. And it's the hymn you sing for Passion Time.
Oh, wow.
And on the Feast of the Exaltation of the Cross. And it is a magnificent, go Google it when you get home. Google Vexillarages and listen to it. And if you sing it at a better tempo, it is fantastic. And it, you know, If you don't sing the Gregorian chants, you know, as sopranos, it's actually very beautiful. So, of course, all these seminarians, you know, we're in our 20s, we're ready for a rumble, right? So we get up and we turn around and they intone the Franciscans, intone the Vexillarius, and we just go for it. Boom! We were so overwhelming. There's no organ, there's no Father Fahnestock up there booming through the basilica. It's just our voices. But we do this thing where it is so loud and echoing. All of a sudden, these Orthodox down at the end around the slab of the anointing are like, well, no, no, no. And they just stop. And it's like, psh, okay, one for us. And then we process, because you're processing up to Calvary, remember? And you always have the Greek priest over standing in the corner watching everything. So I'm explaining all this to you because like 5 or 6 years ago, they mentioned, and it was on international news, BBC broadcasted, that some fight had broken out between two altars or something. And apparently someone was using a thurible. And you could really do some major. It's like the medieval warfare using the morning star, right? That big lump with spikes on it. Yeah. You can really do. So I remember hearing this, and it's like, well, that's horrible. But that's really traditional. That is so...
Awesome.
So the candle, the reason, the lamp is your presence. And so in the basilica, what it represents is your claim to ownership of that altar.
Is our candle lit right now?
Yes.
But there's nobody up there.
Right, because it represents us being there at the altar.
When we're not.
It represents us.
So it's always lit, right, whether there are people or not.
Unless it goes out.
And the candle, unless it goes out and nobody's in the church. But other than that, it's always kept lit because it represents us.
The candles that we light
represent you.
They represent us, but we're doing it in memory of somebody.
Well, I mean, you're praying for something.
For example,
you're praying, it could just be devotion to the Mother of God, and you just want to be there in prayer. So when you light a candle, I mean, the symbolism of the candle is living, it's flame, right?
Mm-hmm.
And the wax is being consumed. So it has a symbolism of consuming myself in the divine service before God. That's why the electric candles just don't really cut it. I mean, part of the symbolism of the candle, you know, in the Eastern tradition, we make like a big box and fill it with sand, and you just stick a taper in it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the chance of the sand catching on fire is like next to nothing. And so you have this. And in France, they do the same thing. Sometimes they have little spikes, and you put them on these spikes, but that's just more cumbersome. The big box of sand is like the best. You just stick it in. You grab your little taper, put your donation in, you light your little taper, you make your prayer, and then you stick it in, and it represents you before the altar, before the icon, whatever it is. And yes, you're there usually for a specific reason. Some people just light candles because I just want to pray for all these, for the intercession of all these people, all these saints. And so it has that all that symbolism behind it. And like I say, donation, you know, there's not a price on the candle. I mean, they'll put a suggested offer.
Mm.
But as when we've gone through the candles, and some people, didn't someone stick like $100 in there one time last year? Yeah, there was a big bill. You know, so it's a donation, because that's also part of what you're offering. And the candle represents you before that icon, that image, being consumed. And as long as it burns, it's your presence. So in Fall River, those 8-day candles, we had people that used to give an annual donation. I wanted to burn all year round in front of St. Charbel. So we had a big painting of St. Charbel. It's in your books. There's a painting in there. It says it's in the center. It's not in the center. It's actually in the church. And we have these 8-day candles in front of it. Okay? That's the meaning of the candles. They're very, very rich, and they're very ancient. And so all the candles, yes.
When my mom was, when her Turkish boyfriend escorted her to midnight mass in Philadelphia in the early 60s, I think, when he found out why mom was lighting a candle,
he said
so
the
it was like a dollar for like the big
one.
He immediately reached in his pocket, took $5, put one for himself, and then one for her parents, and then one for each of her two aunts.
Yeah, because everybody loves them because it's such a natural symbolism, you know, and everybody loves it. So, in this, after the second veil, the same verses in Hebrews, after the second veil is the of the tabernacle, which is called the Holy of Holies, right? So we've been talking about. which having a golden censer and the ark of the testament covered about on every part in gold, in which was the golden pot holding manna from the Exodus and the rod of Aaron inside the ark of the covenant that had blossomed, and the tables of the testament, so the ark, the stones of Mount Sinai were in the tablet. Verse 5 is over and above this were the cherubim, these images. We don't know exactly what they looked like. They probably looked like animals. They probably didn't look like people. They probably looked like animals, the cherubim. Which overshadowing, this is verse 5, overshadowing the propitiatory in this translation. All right? Kaporet. So in the Hebrew, the term is kaporet. I think two P's. Kaporet, yes. Kaporet. Kaporet. The reason why we're looking at this is because the kaporet, and then he says after, he says, and over this with the cherubim, so the space over the ark is referred to as the kaporet, all right, the propitiatory, the mercy seat, it's called in the Psalms, the place of mercy, the place of compassion. And then he just simply says, of which it is not needful now to speak in particular. Now these things being thus ordered, into the first tabernacle the priest indeed always entered, accomplishing the offer of sacrifices, but in the second the high priest alone once a year. Right? And this is in the Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement. So what he's talking about here is what the Jewish Christians did is the symbolism of the kaporet, that place over the ark in the Holy of Holies. Kaporet in the Syriac is husoya. Right? So what in the Hebrew we call the kaporet, the propitiation, is husoya. So that's why the incense is offered there, and it's the reason why only priests can offer incense. Right? Only the priest. The deacon participates in a limited manner in the priesthood. So a deacon could do the incensation. It's why in the Syriac tradition, you never see the priest incensing water or incensing things. He will only incense, as far as things go, the cross and the tomb of our Lord. Because they are the presence of the propitiation or the mercy seat incarnate who is Jesus Christ. So what the Holy of Holies foreshadowed in the temple, behind the second curtain, represented the divine presence. And the divine presence, of course, is revealed to us in the person of our Lord Jesus Christ. So the husoyo that we do at the beginning of the liturgy is our act of conversion. As I mentioned it recently, it's why we have no form of confiteor at the beginning of our liturgy.
What's that?
I confess to Almighty God to you. So in Latin, it's called the confiteor. So the I confess to you, my brother. We don't do that. We don't do it because the husoyo is that bowing before the divine presence, asking for propitiation, asking for mercy. The husoyo is our ceremony of conversion. It is done in Ramsho, it is done in Safro, it is done, as you saw, on Good Friday, it is done in all of our major liturgical ceremonies. And because it is a priestly office, it's only done, like I said, by deacons, priests, and by the bishops. They're the only ones who can offer incense. Okay? Which is why when I was dead as a doornail back in January, December, whenever I had the flu, Saturday I offered the liturgy, and I was like sick as a dog then, and Sunday I couldn't even get up. So I texted Steve to say, all right, you do the reading, no gospel. read the Husoya, but there's no incense. And so everyone was really happy because it only took 35 minutes, right? Basically what was a mutilated form to have a communion service. So, but that's why he didn't do those things or do the gospel, because those are all properly priestly offices. The other reference I want to give you is Hebrews chapter 4, verse 16. Because you have a reference to the living veil of entrance, if you like. And then the third reference is of the building of the ark, the temple itself, or the tabernacle, the tent, which is in the book of Exodus, chapter 25, verse 17. And verse 22. That's especially important text referring to the top, the lid, on top of the Ark of the Covenant. That space above the Ark is, it's of course, it's a space, it's empty, but it represents the place of mercy, which is incarnate in the Christ, in the Messiah. Right? To understand the profundity of the depth of what the Husoyo is. It's not just simply too much incense. It is the very center of our spirituality. Right? The Husoyo is central to everything that we do. It is the major preparation to prepare us to be able to communicate with the Lord God in the anaphora. Okay?
Excuse me, I have a sick husband, so I'm going home.
Wish him well.
I will.
And so, those are the three main quotations of an understanding of the deeper Syriac meaning of the Husoyo. And we'll talk about it in depth, its parts, later on. But to look at, on page 12, there's nothing really to note here. I'm assuming that you're actually reading the books or have read the books already. The title of the book that comes in, Captivated by Your Teachings, he gives you the reference on it from Thursday morning and during the common of the season of after following Pentecost. Captivate us by your teachings. It's actually a request. But when we mention that on page 13, when I mentioned about the Maronite rite or the Maronite church, here you have the proper terminology under the section that says catechetics, Eastern style. And you see in the second little paragraph in that section, on the right hand of the page, you have the italicized word sui juris. S-U-I-J-U-R-I-S. Sui juris. Juris means law. Sui juris means of one's own law. All right? So when you have a terminology of sui juris churches, it means churches that have their own canonical foundation, establishment, tradition, and laws unto themselves. The Maronite Church is one of the canonical churches sui juris. Not all Byzantine churches are sui juris. Some of them are in affiliation, for example, like the Byelorussian Church is not sui juris, it's affiliated with the Russian Church, for example. It's part of the fight that goes on in Ukraine. Is the Ukraine part of the Russian Church, or is it sui juris? Well, the Catholic Ukrainians, of course, are sui juris. So that's its terminology. A rite, R-I-T-E, refers to ceremonies, or manners in which ceremonies are done. Okay? So, that's enough for us to load you with. Bring the Patriarch's letter next week, because we will go back to it over the next couple weeks that we still have left of class. Alright, we'll finish with our closing prayer. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, O God,
you are before all ages, and you resist in age to age. You are resplendent and glorified in unsearchable light. Through your word, you bring forth light and give us each day. O radiant day and source of all light, we glorify you, adore you, and offer you praise night and day. Accept our praise and answer our prayer. Send us your abundant blessings through the mercy of your Messiah. To him with you in the Holy Spirit, be glory, honor, power, and thanksgiving, now. now and forever. Amen.
Glory be to the Father,
and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
O Mary, conceived without sin,
pray for us who have recourse to you.
In the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Father.
Nice seeing everyone.